welcome back to the Nutters Club, where our special guest is Mr. Robyn Judkins, master of the coast-to-coast multi-sports event. Saw the starting line down there, down in Kumara Beach. Oh,
it's beautiful, isn't it? I mean, it's sort of, there's nothing there except the beach.
And statues and of rocks.
And two, yeah, it's beautiful, isn't it?
It is. Absolutely.
It's a lovely, it's a beautiful moment to be there at the start of the race. But I found also that I always go down there, whenever I go over the coast, and I go about five times a year, I'll always go down to the start because I really do get a really nice emotional feeling about it myself. And I also always pick up something off the beach.
Yeah.
And I always take home a piece of driftwood or a stone. And I'm always looking for that elusive piece of punamu.
So, you've had an amazing life.
Fairly colourful life, yeah, I would have said so far.
What was the first encounter you ever had with mental health services? And what did they make of you?
Well, no, they all think I'm mad, don't they? I mean, let's not beat around the bush, David. Stop looking at me as if I was a goat tethered up, ready to be strung, horned, and dehorned and quartered and served up to some sort of Moroccan dish, lamb dish perhaps.
Sorry, I'll put my magnifying glass away.
Yeah, let me tell you, it's sort of a hodgepodge, really. At one stage there in the 1990s, I got terribly, terribly stressed. I was under attack.
By the voices in your head?
No, by an environmental group. Oh. And they thought, wrongly as it turned out, but they thought that I was Attila the Hun of the environment because I ran events in the beautiful, pristine mountains and so on. So they mounted a very, very concerted campaign against me in 1992 when I tried to do an event on the Milford track called the Milford Mountain Marathon, and we just got so badly attacked, and I had death threats and real death threats. I mean, hey, can you imagine this? I walk in the door and I pick the phone up, and the guy said, "Is that Robyn Judkins?" And I said, "Yeah, yes, it is." He said, "Were you at Christchurch Airport this morning at 8:35? I'm going, "What? Who's this?" "Were you at such and such an address, my mother's address, at 10:30? I'm going, "What?" He said, "You and your family are dead meat." And then click. And I go, "Holy crackers." And, you know, the result of that is that my wife, who worked at the hospital then, had to go, she just instantly go and take the kids out of school.
Yeah.
And flee. And in this case, went to Akaroa with them, right? Chunk. Just gone. And then I have to go around and just, you know, the first thing you do is you literally go around your house.
Yeah.
You do. I armed myself with a bloody great knife out of the kitchen, and I went right around the whole house because this person could be there or could have somebody there. And so that's the style. That's what was happening, you know. And so the stress levels were incredible, just incredible. And then I cancelled it because it just became just horrible.
Yeah.
And And it got worse. It just got seemed to get worse and worse. And it was also difficult to make myself be believed in a situation like this too. Like people were not, they were, it seems slightly unreal even at this distance that those sorts of things can happen. That stress and all of that is pretty much the same, I think. You know, they're all intertwined because if you're suffering from any mental illness, you're under a tremendous amount of stress.
Yep.
You are.
Yep.
I mean, everything goes to pack. Your eating habits are destroyed. Your environment you live in is devastated. The people that you live with turn against you. You know, no one can cope with it.
So your problems were all stress-related?
When this, you know, incredible stress occurred, 92, I was put on antidepressants.
Mm-hmm.
And I stayed on those for 8 years. Two different types, one in the morning, one in the evening. And in 2000, in 1997 rather, so that was 5 years after I started or whatever, yeah, I noticed a whole range of different things occurring. And then, this is a cracker, in 2000, I became quite ill with this. And I went to see a psychiatrist and said, and I took all my pills with me. It was just spectacular. I walked in and I said, he said, what? Because people know me, but I don't know them.
Yeah.
So he knew who I was. And he looked up at me as I walked in the door. He said, what are you doing here? And I said, well, I'm probably mad. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here. He said, sit down. He said, what are you taking? And I went, bang, 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 bang. And he literally, he said, well, you read them out. What are they? I said, my God, my God, my God. Get to the last two. And he said, which were the two antidepressants, one in the morning, one in the evening. He said, well, there have been no clinical trials that I know of the combination of those two. How could this ever be connected? And that was the incredible shocks, electric shocks, that you received that went from your head through to your foot and disappeared out your foot. And this could occur when you were lying down or standing up. Now, when you touch your key to the outside of a car or you put your hand on the car, you get an electric shock. Mm. You get one also from walking on nylon carpets. And you'll get one when you've got nylon clothes on and you shake somebody's hand. They are nothing. You get a shock from an electric fence. That's pretty intense, especially if you're doing a whittle on it at the time and the electric current goes right up
you. Spoken like a good Canterbury boy.
That was a trick that was played on me when I was a very small child. And I believe it had a great deal to do with what happened to me later. Anyway, the electric shocks that I was getting intense.
Feelings.
They are. Yeah. They are so intense. Yep. They're about 2 to 3 times what you're getting off an electric fence. And they just go... Bam!
Are they real shocks?
It's not an electrical thing, but it isn't like a nervous system thing that happens to people. And I mean, it's certainly a recognised side effect. I mean, I'd be intrigued to know what the combination of 8 damn things you were on was. But
he's not telling you.
Most often, actually, those kind of jolt type experiences are with withdrawal, particularly of some antidepressants. Yeah,
it could be. I was getting them before while I was still on them, though.
Yeah.
But then initially, I was told that the side effects would wear off within 6 months. Then that was increased to 2 years, and then basically it was just, who knows. Right. So I'm susceptible to having...
So why in God's name did you carry on taking them so long?
Oh, I think...
Because the white coat told them to.
Well, partly the white coat. Yeah. And really, it was also to preserve... some equanimity in the house, I think.
Okay.
Because you remember that under stress, when people get terribly stressed, it has that effect of also stressing other people in the house as well, you know. So, and you've got to also understand, you guys, that I come from a background of, you realise that I'm a recovered alcoholic. So I gave up the booze in 1978. Now, I've had 32 years off the booze. So, and I've also given up cigarettes. So I'm off that as well. I've been down through that withdrawal sign. And I've also given up coffee, which was a cracker. And I've got some things to say about that in relationship to everything else that occurs in the real world.
You and I have a lot of similarities. I mean, I'm bipolar.
You're bipolar.
Like, I have manic highs, but I also have pretty shitty lows. Mm-hmm. Do you get those? I mean, everyone can hear the laughter.
Oh, yeah. Well, I suppose, yeah, you do, yeah. It's usually over some particular thing. It's not a general thing. It's usually I've got some particular problem that I'm trying to cope with or get around or find the answer to.
We are sitting in the studio with Robyn Judkins, and if something just went click in your brain and you'd like to ask him about it, our number is 0800 723 465. Give us a call. We're taking your calls right after the break.